Hello everyone, welcome to my show Rocket Monday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at the update, September update of BFR. So let's dive right into it. So update happened on SpaceX headquarters itself, and it happened on September 2018. So what you have to understand, BFR, before all the updates was announced, before this specific update, all we knew that there is gonna be a rocket, there's gonna be a launch platform, but we did not know which mission is gonna be used. This is the crucial aspect. This time they're gonna introduce a mission. So what is the mission? Mission is to go around the moon, not land on the moon, just go around the moon. This, understand this very carefully. This is not Apollo project. They're just gonna go around the moon. Now Apollo project also had, like in Apollo 9 and 10, I'm not sure about that, but in that mission they did the same thing that was done as a dress rehearsal. So it is doing the same thing. BFR is not gonna land on the moon, it's just gonna go around and come back. Expected time to for this trip is like 1 week or something like that. Now they also announced the world's first paid tourist for moon mission. This guy, Yokasi Matsukuga, and he's basically a fashion designer. The money he's supposed to have, his net worth shows somewhere around $2 to $3 billion, and there are a lot of BFR design updates that Elon Musk himself provided. So there is no, like, your sources are not correct, this is from him. So a summary of the situation is that we're gonna go around the moon, there is a guy who's gonna pay for it, and there has been some design updates. So what are those updates? The biggest, the most crucial aspect of it is that they rechanged the BFR, as in the payload capacity now has been changed. The many of you know the older design that was interplanetary transport was planning to go for roughly 300 tons to low Earth orbit. Then they scaled it back to BFR. BFR is meant to do roughly 150 tons to low Earth orbit. This BFR 2.0 is gonna sell it down even further. Now they are at 100 tons. However, the crucial fact between this BFR 1 versus BFR 2 is that BFR 2 will have larger volume, as in the size of the payload can be much larger. They are aiming for 1000 cubic meter. Now it may change, so please don't go, like, you know, all ham on this. It could change. So their target audience, they realized quite early that we don't send lead to space. So having a very, very big launch capacity really does not translate much if you can't send big enough. As in space shuttle module, like International Space Station modules, even the biggest module, that Japanese module there is, it's not that heavy. So, but it is big, but it's not heavy. So they are going for lighter and larger payloads. They added wings. Why? Basically, they want to save fuel on the return trip. Now, will this be a positive change? Maybe, maybe not, because you have to understand the fuel saving they will gain by not doing re-entry burn will maybe wasted by simply the fact that wings not only add mass, but they also add drag while you're going through the atmosphere. So this is there needs to be far more calculation in real life before we figure out how much benefit we actually gain from doing this. So don't just jump on it like, you know, this is the best thing ever. There may be consequence to this. Now, of course, overall, I think there will be 10 to 15% benefit of doing this, because re-entry burn is really, really fuel intensive. So saving fuel on that front is kind of wise. Now you have to be mindful of this landing, basically this landing leg and wings are the same structure, so they are, you know, doing multi-purpose. However, be mindful, this canard thing is not a wing. The rear ones can provide some lift, but they are not there as a lifting body. It's not like space shuttle where it was using that to land. This is only there to add drag, only there to, you know, help basically BFR lose its energy. Basically they want to dump all the energy that they gained by going up there into the atmosphere. They're like, okay, atmosphere, take our energy away, so I have to do very small suicide burn, which they do at the end. So this is their target. And in the terms of engine, there has been some updates. The first biggest factor is that now engine is aiming for much higher chamber pressure, which will mean higher thrust output. And they are only gonna use sea level engine. In my video about SpaceX, I specified the sole reason SpaceX is even cost competitive is because they are using one engine to rule them all, one Merlin engine. Here they're gonna use Raptor engine. Now in Merlin engine design, they knew Merlin engine well enough, so they changed the nozzles. Basically they had sea level nozzle and one vacuum optimized nozzle. However, in this, they are not gonna make a vacuum optimized nozzle because I seriously think this is solely done because they will not gain enough from it. Like adding mass of big nozzles will not give them too much benefit, and not to mention this will streamline their process. Now Falcon 9 only has 10 engines. This will have much more than that. You have to understand the first stage itself, the booster stage, may have as high as 30 engines or 31 engines, and this has 9 engines. So suffice to say, streamlining the production lineup is going to be crucial. So these are the updates. Now be mindful, now this rocket cannot compete against Saturn V. Saturn V still remains the king of super heavy lift rocket. It can take care of 130 tons to low Earth orbit. So payload change, you have to understand, also plays a very crucial role in terms of finance. Like how much payload they can send and how fast they can send it defines how much money they can charge. Now the biggest danger of this is now it's lower than SLS Block 2, not raw SLS. The first SLS that will be launched will barely have 90 ton, but SLS versions, as they will be polished, they will go upwards of 150 ton is the target, but they know they can easily get upwards of 130 tons. So suffice to say, this creates a very, very tough place for BFR, not only because it can send heavier payload, but it can also send heavier payload faster. Now Scott Penley did a very interesting video on this, and I urge you to check it out, because specific impulse plays a very crucial role in rockets. If you have higher specific impulse, which you will get if you are using hydrogen as a fuel, not methane, hydrogen as a fuel, you can send, even if you have the same amount of mass, as in like, let's say your fuel mass is only 100 tons, as in like oxygen and hydrogen combined, like you have 100 tons of propellant, you can send it much farther if you have hydrogen. Only problem is that hydrogen does not have enough thrust. So, but if, once you are in vacuum, it's not fighting against the serious amount of gravity, and it's not fighting against the atmosphere. So it can really work. That's why NASA is sticking with hydrogen, because it gives the best mileage. In terms, this actually means they can send much heavier payload to Jupiter for studying their moons, Jupiter or Saturn's moon, and they can send it much faster. So a BFR maybe do that in 6 years, they can cut down upwards of a few months to 2 years, they can cut down on travel time. Please watch that Scott Manley video, it's quite interesting. And not to mention, because they are in a, such an odd, awkward place, that let's say NASA needs to send something heavy, but it's not 150 tons, so they're not gonna use their BFR. It's not also 100 ton, they cannot use basically the SpaceX rocket. New Glenn plays a very crucial role here. Now, of course, not of course that rocket, that is just a troll rocket. So the rocket New Glenn is planning to do, basically Blue Origin's New Glenn rocket, it's going for 60 ton. So it's higher than what Falcon Heavy can do, not because Falcon Heavy does not have the thrust, Falcon Heavy has a thrust, but it's structurally not sound enough to carry 60 ton. So Falcon, basically Falcon Heavy is out compared to that. So Blue Origin can really, really take care of things here. So their payload change, the fact now that it is lower than SLS, the fact now it's slower than SLS, really, really hampers their profitability. Now there are missing details that kind of bugged me, and I would urge you, if you know about these, please comment down below. But are they gonna do orbital refueling? The reason why I'm asking is that A, they don't need it for moon mission, basically if they're doing a turn around the moon, and not to mention they had a full scale printout, as in 1-to-1 scale printout, but they did not had any of these small pipes on those diagram. And I checked and checked, but there was no pipe like that. So there is a chance that they may not have this. They will of course add it in the future version, but this version that they are aiming for, it does not have it so far. So, and will they have landing legs on the booster? That is also not confirmed. And everybody who's saying like, you know, you can land the booster directly on the clamps, launch clamps. Yeah, it's doable, but like it's playing with fire, it's kind of risky. And not to mention, this is the part that I'm not getting any satisfying answer to this. If you have this, please provide it to me, that how the heck they're gonna handle the payload fairing. This is SLS biggest advantage. As you can see, SLS fairing size, they're humongous. Basically, to give you the idea, they are also aiming for a 10 meter fairing that's gonna have volume of roughly 1800 meters square. So suffice to say, they can send a very big module of International Space Station or Deep Space Gateway to basically orbit quite comfortably. Now, not to mention, they have a fairing that simply falls off, like exactly like Falcon, basically Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy. So everything is awesome there. However, how the heck they're going to handle the fairing here? Because they can't, this was the old design where they did not have any canard. So even in this design they are showing, they can only open it to 50% because there's going to be heat shield here. Now, to be sure, there is a way to make sure that heat shield can be opened and closed. Space shuttle used to do that. It landing leg used to go in the heat shield. There was a basically door that can seal it. But suffice to say, it was ludicrously complex, and that was the place that was inspected for most rigorously inspected, because that's a point of failure. And SpaceX realized that having a heat shield that pokes out or in is very dangerous. So they flat out removed the landing legs from their Red Dragon capsule, because they can't do it, it's doable, it's just ludicrously complex. So they removed the landing legs because it used to protrude out of the heat shield. So in this design, this was the only design I can get out of them, is then they only gonna have the open 50% open in the front. Now if they can open 50%, that's okay, but problem is, this is not like space shuttle was designed so it can go like this, then turn like this, then open the cargo bay door and your payload will come out, your cylindrical payload will come out. This cannot do that because it's a cone like structure, and this whole area is fuel tank. You can't really have that open door structure, it's not gonna be very wise. So fairings really play an important role here. This may limit them, this may come back and bite them, because of this odd structures they can't open a fairing. And because now they have added fairings, I don't think they can even reach 50%. They can't reach 50% opening capacity. The best they can go for is 60%, because this is a cylindrical structure. So opening payload door may become their biggest trouble. Can they do it? Like, you know, can they have this part also come off? Yes, it's doable. However, it's kind of ludicrously complex, not impossible, and complex. It's complex, and not to mention, because the seam will be very big, is the seam area would be much bigger than what the space shuttle had to handle. So suffice to say, this I really need to know about this. How the heck they're gonna have a payload fairing that allows them to send big payloads? They have the capacity. They got the capacity. They got the volume. How they're gonna deploy it? That, now that's the unknown part, because space shuttle could go like this horizontal and then open the door and just launch it. This cannot do that easily. So are they gonna have a scenario where they're gonna have a heat shield that comes off? So things of that nature really needs to be known. And be mindful, now SLS is much more attractive than BFR, simply because A, the fairings are super simple, B, it can launch heavier, C, it can launch faster. So all things combined, BFR is no longer like, holy crap, this is amazing. And I really need to know whether they have the, I don't think they are going for refueling capacity at the first launch, but that means they have to redesign the whole vehicle again. And are we really gonna put astronauts in a place where there is no launch abort? I'm still not curious, because some people did ask the question. Everyday astronaut did ask the question, can, because these engines are now changed from vacuum to sea level, they can fire on a launch pad. So it is possible that if the booster blows up, they can fire the engine and move away. Will they do that? I don't think so, but it's up to you. Are you comfortable with this idea? Space shuttle did not have launch escape system and suffered lethal fatalities because of that. You can check my videos on that, and that's why I'm really not comfortable with this idea. The first, the fairing, because this is gonna really hamper how much utility you can get out of this, because NASA is directly going all out on this, and not having landing legs on the boosters, I think they're gonna add it. I have a feeling they're gonna add it. Now we come to cost and time. This is the biggest problem with Elon Musk. Like, Elon Musk does a very good work, but I really wish somebody can make sure that he never comes into the contact with public. Just do your work, let your work speak for you. Don't speak directly, because every time he says something and I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna do a flyby in 2022. No, not gonna happen. Now, the reason why SpaceX is very financially successful, you can check my video on that, is I'm gonna give you a TLDR of that, is that because they cut out middlemen and they are a private company, it's in their best interest to save money. It's not in the best interest of NASA's supplier to save money, because if they charge more, NASA has to pay them more. And based on that, let's say they are charging $10 million, they're gonna get a cut of it. Now, if they are charging $100 million, they're gonna still get the same cut from it. So let's say the cut is 10%, you realize, like, if they can give you a $10 million bill or $100 million bill is more profitable. So This is why NASA was struggling so heavily with, even though NASA has a lot of money, because there are so many middlemen, and because there is a scenario where the more expensive you make it, the more profit you get. This is why basically James Webb Space Telescope is struggling so badly. Like, there is no reason, like no reason in hell that it should cost $10 billion. That's the cost of this, that Elon Musk is aiming for. Like $10 billion for a space telescope that is behind schedule, like, and we are no longer even sure that it's gonna be launched at this point. So you have to understand, the reason why NASA, NASA's supplier don't want to save money is because they will lose profit. So first thing is first. Second is that NASA has a lot of supply chain. Basically, think of it this way. In case of Saturn V, IBM makes a basically logistical unit, basically compute module for them. And IBM itself does not make the microprocessor. The microprocessor may be made by, I do not know the exact company, but it might be Texas Instrument or things of that nature. Basically, there are many, many layers of what you call supply chain. So basically, one maker will make a chain, then send it to another chain. One link would be added, then sent to another one, sent to another one, sent to another. Then at the end, it goes to NASA. Basically, you are talking about upwards of five chain. So five chain means everyone will take their small cut, otherwise they will not do the work. So what SpaceX is doing is trying to minimize that. Instead of having five, they are only doing two. So they are like, okay, they'll directly go to the basically processor manufacturer. They're like, okay, you're gonna make the silicon. They directly went to the guy who makes the PCB company in China, and they're like, okay, just combine that and you send it to me. I'm gonna do the assembly, final assembly in my own factory. And they're like, okay, one guy makes the turbo pump, but another guy makes the basically chamber for the engine. They're like, you send it to me, you're gonna send it to me. So they are not doing a recollaboration mid-air where you're not tuk multiple things, like how IBM did that for Saturn V. This way they can remove way too many bottlenecks. They can remove way too many basically money sink, as they call it. So after removing those many money sink, rockets are inherently cheap. SpaceX already successfully proven that. However, his target point is not nowhere near. Like, he's saying 2025, basically. 2025 is too close. Like, it's not gonna happen if they are only putting 5% of SpaceX, which they specified, because their current target is sending astronauts to ISS and getting USA back its manned mission capability. And their core target right now is that mission, sending astronauts safely and, you know, bringing them back safely. So all things considered, at 5%, there is no chance in hell they're gonna achieve that 2025 target. And not to mention, R&D cost that is cited was $10 billion. Now, that's way too less. Like, he was saying $8 to $10 billion. No, it's not gonna, that's super less. That's the cost of basically Large Hadron Collider, before which we already knew how much it's gonna cost. And we knew, like, the biggest cost was, like, you know, digging that long and making some things. Particle accelerator was cheap, but the detectors were expensive. So having that kind of attitude, like, you know, it's only gonna cost $10 billion, that's hubris to say. And his timeline is too close. It's like, yeah, I'm gonna start today and tomorrow I'm gonna finish. Like, people are saying, like, oh, they have this. It's a tooling machine. Basically, it's like giving you someone a hammer and it's like, okay, now we are ready to build a house. There's a giant time gap between that. So, and the image that they are showing in the Instagram, I think that was just a practice run, because they were walking on it with shoes, which you will not do if this is the final product. So I think any new tool you get, you make a, you know, practice run basically. So I think they were doing that, not final product. So the timeline is too good. Now, this part really pisses me off, that for some reason so many educated people kind of slip on this. Is like, when Elon Musk says it's gonna cost less than $10 million per launch, that's absolutely true. Elon Musk can get it that low. However, he's not gonna charge you $10 million. This is like saying Apple spends $300 to make their iPhone X. They're not gonna sell you iPhone X for $300. They're gonna sell you it for $1,100, because you have to understand the final cost will be determined by the actual cost, the, you know, fuel, the licenses, the launch pad, everything they have to buy and license. That's the final cost. Then they are saying they can reduce it as low as $10 million. Okay, awesome. Who's gonna pay that $10 billion that they spent on R&D? Now, the sole reason that Falcon 9 can even do this is simply because the R&D cost of Falcon 9 is taken care of by NASA. That's why they can really send their launches that cheaply. They're like, yeah, only $20 or $30 million per launch. That's the why, because the R&D money they did not have to worry about. NASA just gave them $400 million for to develop their system. Now, if this happens with BFR, of course, they can really take care of this part. However, I'm not sure of this. And that billionaire contribution is just not big enough. And not to mention, with these two combined, then we come to the profit. Because if there is no profit, nobody's gonna do it. Flat out. Nobody's gonna do it. You can't just take $10 billion and just like, you know, burn it, because you can just keep that money in a bank and you will get interest on it. So suffice to say, all three things combined is gonna be very expensive. Now, there can be few more billionaires come up front and take care of the R&D budget. NASA can chip in, like once they start seeing any progress and any track, NASA can be like, okay, I will take care of your R&D budget. So then, only then the cost will be the final cost of like $5 to $10 million per launch. So this is the part that pisses me off. Everybody is like, you know, SpaceX is so cheap. It's not cheap because it's cheap. It's cheap because NASA take care of the R&D part of it. That is a very big part. So it's like Apple charges Apple pays $300 for the hardware. But what the engineers that design the chip, the bionic chip engineers, you have to pay for them. What about the software artists that you know, designed everything? What about the software coders that built your operating system? So those things people are kind of you know, neglecting. That's why SpaceX is so profitable, because NASA took care of the big chunk of it. So this was my presentation on our current update. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, you can dislike it. And I would suggest you leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Future Friday. And I urge you to subscribe. And you don't have to press the bell icon. You don't have to do that. But just subscribe. Come on, you can do it. I have faith in you. And as always, thanks for watching.